Quest presents an unabridged recording of Made to be Broken by Emma Salisbury, narrated by Nicholas Camm. Part 1. Day 1. Chapter 1. A tent had already been erected around the body in the front of the truck. The police vans parked along the edge of the pedestrian square had attracted the attention of workers from neighbouring office blocks. An army of fluorescent jackets held back the crowd that had gathered. A reporter with scuffed heels and hair extensions watched two male detectives climb out of an unmarked car and made a beeline for them, shoving her phone under the nearest victim's chin.
"Anything you can tell us about the victims?"
She made it sound like an accusation.
"Quick off the blocks, are you?"
DS Kevin Coupland paused as his gaze locked onto the familiar face.
"No motorway pile-ups to get your false nails into," he growled, aware that DCI Malander was already at the cordon shouting his name as he beckoned him over. "Served by the yell," Coupland added, dismissing her.
The scene of crime officer nodded as Coupland approached the cordon.
"Nice to see your media training in action," she smirked.
Coupland had worked crime scenes with her before. She wasn't as thorough as Turnbull, but she got the job done.
"You took your time," she added. "Been here an hour already."
Coupland jerked his thumb in the direction of the vehicle he'd driven over in.
"In case you haven't noticed, it's a car, not a TARDIS."
It came out sharper than he intended. He'd never been one to take criticism well, especially when it wasn't deserved.
"For your information, we've only just got the call, Detective Constable," he added, reminding her of the pecking order.
The Socko raised her hands and grimaced.
"Sorry, Sarge, bad choice of words. Blame it on low blood sugar."
It had been traffic's shout at first. The original report that came in had stated a collision between a truck and a pedestrian. When the first officers on the scene took the driver's account, he claimed the victim had thrown himself in front of the truck. It was only when the truck's dashcam footage was checked that it was obvious he'd been pushed. The shout was assigned to Salford Precinct Murder Squad as they were nearest to the locus. The road, a major route into Salford's financial district, had been closed for the best part of 2 hours.
"Like what you've done to the place," Coupland observed.
Yellow evidence markers had been placed either side of a triangular sandwich carton and a mobile phone with a shattered screen. A leather wallet lay beside it. Further along, a black brogue lay midway across the road.
Coupland huffed out a sigh, his gaze travelling to the tent that had been erected around the front of the truck to conceal what was left of the body.
The Socko followed his gaze.
"A lot of his personal effects were chewed up under the truck's front wheels. He must have let go of his phone trying to save himself. I'll get it to you once it's been logged. There were several business cards inside the wallet which I've passed to your boss."
"And the driver?" The Socko pointed in the direction of a squad car with two occupants in it parked beside several police vans. Coupland's nod was slow.
"Look on the bright side," she said. "At least you've got time of death."
"As pep talks go, I've heard better," Coupland muttered before heading into the tent. DCI Malander stepped back to let him get a closer look, but there wasn't much to see. An arm was visible jutting out at an angle between the body of the truck's cab and the curb. A heavy chrome diving watch on the wrist was intact.
"You hope to Christ when something like this happens that it's instant," Coupland muttered, turning back to the DCI, "that the poor bugger didn't have a scoop in what was literally about to hit him."
Malander handed him a business card taken from a folded evidence bag.
"Adam Sinclair, financial advisor from Bridgewater Asset Management," Coupland read aloud. "We certain it's him."
"The cards have all got the same name on them, so I'm guessing they're his," replied Malander. "I've taken a photo of what you can see underneath the truck's rig," he added, handing Coupland his phone. Coupland squinted at the screen, tapping it before widening the image with his forefinger and thumb.
"Jesus H. Christ," he muttered, blowing out his cheeks before handing the phone back as though it was contaminated. "It'll be a closed casket," he grunted, turning back to where Adam was pinned between two wheels. Only part of his face was intact. They'd be able to make an ID of sorts. The rest of him lay at awkward angles. Some body parts were beyond recognition. It was unlikely he'd be lifted into a body bag in one go. Fire and rescue were on standby to move the truck once we give them the signal. Coupland glanced at the waiting crew with something akin to sympathy. His job was to work out who had caused this, but it was their job to get him off the tarmac. Having no desire to see for himself what Malander had already shown him on his phone, he stepped away from the carnage. "Want me to do the honours with this?" he asked, holding up the business card. "I'll get his employer to confirm his whereabouts and send me a recent photo." He waited for Malander to nod his approval before stepping outside the tent, holding in a breath as he studied his surroundings. It was part of the city where the old met the new, concrete 70s-style office blocks dwarfed by glass and chrome towers. The commercial district was walking distance from Salford Central Station. The streets were populated by sales reps searching for parking spaces and office workers nipping out for lunch. A construction site occupied the next block, tradesmen in high-vis jackets and hard hats moving about the site like worker ants on a hill. It was a public place to die. Broad daylight, too. Coupland eyed the CCTV camera on the office building behind him, his gaze sweeping the remainder of the block for another. They needed to move swiftly, get access to them before the footage was erased. An appeal would go out for dashcam footage from vehicles that had travelled along the same stretch of road. Passers-by would need to be traced, interviewed and eliminated. There'd been an incident a couple of years back. A male jogger in London had pushed a woman in front of an oncoming bus. Only the swift action of the driver saved her. The CCTV footage released at the time went viral, yet failed to catch the would-be killer. The crowd that had gathered beyond the cordon were mainly workers and delivery drivers who, for the time being, would be unable to gain access to the retail units and business premises only steps away from where the victim fell. Beyond the crowd, a pedestrianised square where several wine bars with pavement seating advertised midweek specials. Small groups of onlookers made their way towards them. No harm in a swift drink while they waited for the cordon to be lifted. A coffee shop nestled between a slugging lettuce and Tony Macaroni. Through the large glass windows, sofas and high-backed chairs clustered around small tables. A man wearing earplugs sat in an armchair tapping into his phone. Coupland stepped inside, ordered three lattes and a cellophane-wrapped chocolate brownie that he pocketed along with a handful of sugar sachets from the self-service counter on the way out. He headed towards the squad car parked in the blocked-off area of road, nodding at the officer sat in the driver's seat. A decent enough cop, though his lack of height caused a stir when he'd first joined the force, earning him the name Laptop because he was a small PC. Coupland peered through the window into the rear of the car. A man in his 40s sat with a foil blanket over his shoulders, the type given to marathon runners at the end of a race. He'd been driving the truck that had ploughed into the victim. He looked shell-shocked. The weather was clear and visibility was good, but nothing could have prepared him for what happened. Coupland opened the door and climbed in, pausing before handing out the coffee. "Preliminary's been taken care of?" he asked. Laptop nodded, causing the truck driver to sigh. "Let's get one thing straight. I wasn't on the phone, I wasn't texting. I had both hands on the wheel and was looking straight ahead, and I absolutely haven't been drinking." "Breathalyzed at the scene, Sarge. Negative," Laptop added when Coupland turned to him for corroboration. Satisfied, Coupland held the cardboard coffee tray out so they could help themselves, fishing in his pocket for the sachets of sugar which he tossed onto the tray. "Cheers, Sarge," Laptop said in a tone which suggested he was normally an afterthought when it came to detectives putting their hand in their pocket. The truck driver's hand shook as he tore open a sachet. "Supposed to be good for shark rate," he said, tipping the contents into his paper cup. "Ever had anything like this happen before?" Coupland asked, his question met with a vigorous shake of the head. "Are you kidding me? I've been warned about pavement suicides when I started in the job, but no one ever mentioned someone literally being thrown under the bus." The truck's dashcam footage had downgraded him from suspect to witness, but he was a victim in this too. He'd never drive along this stretch of road again without bracing for impact, recalling images that should never be seen. Skin welded to the front of his truck, human smears on the tarmac. Coupland glanced at Laptop. "You taking his statement?" Yes, Sarge, he replied in a tone that implied he wasn't a fuckwit. Coupland took a gulp of his coffee, studying the driver over the plastic lid of his cup. He looked as though he'd been muscular once before fast food and sitting still for hours on end took its toll. The forearm gripping his coffee was tattooed. A woman's face. Wife, mother, ex. Coupland couldn't be sure. Do you recall seeing anyone else on the pavement apart from the victim? The driver shook his head. Like I already said to the officer here, I was more interested in what was going on in front of me. On the road, the whole thing only took about 3-4 seconds. There was nothing I could do. I saw him jump out in the corner of my eye and I tried to swerve to the other lane to get out of his way. Then I heard a bang and knew it was too late.
Coupland looked at laptop pointedly.
You've got this down as well?
Another Sarge, though this time through gritted teeth. The truck driver gulped down the remainder of his coffee.
I've still got deliveries to make. When can I get back to work?
The only place that truck's going when fire and rescue have done with it is the police compound for further tests. This road's going to be shut for the rest of the day, Coupland responded, turning to open the car door. The truck driver regarded him sharply.
What about me? What do I do in the meantime?
It was vital in these situations that a support network was in place for when the shock began to dissipate. Loved ones, workmates, a manager who gave a toss about your welfare. Even so, the patience of those around you came with its own time limit. It was easy to look inwards, to absorb blame, to question whether you could have done more. Coupland stepped out of the car, lowering his head to eyeball the truck driver once more.
If you get offered counselling, I suggest you take it.
The Socco leaned into the back of an estate car, cross-checking sealed evidence bags against the scene of crime log on her clipboard.
I see you've acquainted yourself with the driver, she said to Coupland, inclining her head in the direction of the squad car he climbed out of. Poor bugger, he wasn't bargaining on this when he started his shift today.
I'm sure the victim wasn't either, Coupland observed, his eyes skimming the contents of each evidence bag. The black brogue with a hand-stitched leather sole, the designer watch, a torn triangular carton containing a sandwich the victim had expected to eat. Coupland patted his pockets for the brownie he'd bought earlier.
I nearly forgot, he said, handing it over. Got something for that blood sugar of yours. Blimey, I take it all back, she gasped, in much the same tone laptop had earlier. What is it with everyone? I can do nice, you know,
Coupland said, his arms raised in frustration.
You've got to admit, Sarge, you hide it well.
Tossing his empty coffee cup into the nearest bin, Coupland followed a tree-lined walkway into a landscaped open square. The street sign attached to an adjacent building stated New Bailey Plaza, the address on Adam Sinclair's business card. The square consisted of a newly built development of smart office blocks and upmarket eateries. The open area was landscaped with shrubs and benches. Communal seating areas were dotted here and there, a place for people to linger rather than rush from A to B. Uniformed officers would soon begin making inquiries in neighbouring offices. It was feasible the culprit worked locally, committed murder in their lunch break while nipping out for a vegan burrito. Coupland walked around the perimeter, his eyes scanning the offices and retail outlets. He couldn't think of the last time he'd been in this part of the city. He'd never had call to require any of its services. Private banking, financial planning, accountancy, law, the commercial kind, not criminal justice and conveyancing. People moved with purpose between towering office blocks. Things were starting to return to normal for many, now lockdown had eased. In a few hours, workers would swarm out of their offices into the square and avenues to either start their commute home or flop into one of the many restaurants for a bite to eat. The people that worked here dressed up to go to work, tailored clothing from high-end stores, money to socialise with colleagues, not just friends. Even so, how many could afford a watch like the victim's? Coupland pulled his phone and Sinclair's business card from his pocket, keyed in the head office number for Bridgewater Asset Management before hitting the call button. Afternoon briefing, CID room, Salford Precinct Station.
When I rang head office, the receptionist put me through to the company's MD, a Dominic Neilson. He confirmed that Adam Sinclair worked for them and was able to email me a photo of him taken a few weeks ago when he'd trounced his quarterly sales target. Coupland held up the photo of Sinclair as he beamed into the camera, a champagne flute in one hand and a cheque in the other. Thick white hair and lived-in features gave him the look of an elder statesman, albeit one on the take. Coupland placed it on the newly erected instant board beside the photo taken at the locus. The likeness was uncanny if you ignored the fact that in the crime scene photo half the victim's face was missing. Ashcroft is delivering the death message now. DC Turnbull peered at the close-up photo of Sinclair's watch that had also been pinned to the board. Beneath it, the make and value, an Omega Speedmaster moonwatch, just shy of £5,000.
Don't see many of them that aren't knock-off. Must be loaded, he observed.
Thank you for your sparkling insight, Turnbull, Coupland said. Anything else you'd care to add, or shall I crack on?
Turnbull was right, though. This wasn't their typical shout, where a murder involved a drug deal gone wrong or a pissed-up brawl. Coupland pushed on.
So why would someone shove a pinstripe-suited businessman into the path of a truck in broad daylight? What does the firm do? Asked DC Robinson.
Coupland studied Sinclair's business card.
Wealth management, whatever that means.
Financial advice for those who no longer need it, observed Malinder, who'd been happy to let Coupland run the briefing. They invest clients' money, take a percentage of profits made, and charge a management fee on top, even if the investments make no money at all. The assembled detectives considered this. Malinder, out of any of them, was the one most likely to know about such things.
Imagine having so much money you didn't know what to do with it, said Turnbull.
Nope, said Coupland after a beat. I have a wife and daughter, remember?
Not to mention a grandson, none of them bargained for. Coupland inclined his head in the direction of a tall, athletic black man who had entered the room. Newly promoted DS Ashcroft had been with the team for 3 years, following a brief spell with the Met where a bright future as a poster boy beckoned, he'd returned to GMP to earn his stripes under his own steam. Ashcroft inclined his head in return.
How did his wife take it? Asked Coupland.
Ashcroft hooked a finger into the knot of his tie to loosen it. He shrugged off his jacket, placing it over the back of his chair.
She's in shock. Wasn't able to say much. Said I'd go back later. Flo's with her now.
Crispy had been studying his computer screen.
Sarge, he piped up, his tone causing Coupland to glance at him sharply. Adam Sinclair was released from HMP Manchester 5 months ago after serving a 4-year sentence for death by dangerous driving.
Was he now? Observed Coupland.
Then to the rest of the room.
I think we might have just found the reason.
Any information on the hit-and-run victim? Asked DCI Malinder. Crispy shook his head. He was the most junior member of the team. His fresh face evidenced his faith in people hadn't been crushed by the job yet. His fondness for icing-covered donuts, hence his nickname, resulted in his suits fitting him more snugly than they used to.
Nothing as yet, sir. I've put in a request for the crime report.
Malinder nodded his approval. Check with local bail hostels and mental health units while you're at it. See if anyone's gone walkabout. Can't rule anything out at this stage, especially in the light of this information.
Get onto the jail and find out who he associated with while he was there, instructed Coupland, nodding towards DC's Turnbull and Robinson. Whether he was friendly with any known faces.
Malinder regarded the incident board, studying the photo Sinclair's boss had emailed over before studying the crime scene photo.
Our chap gets more interesting by the minute. Looks like he belonged to a private members club too. The Clifton Club, he added, pointing out the red and gold crest on Sinclair's blue tie.
Coupland had thought it was smeared blood and tissue.
You're the only person in the room who'd have picked that up, boss, intoned Coupland. You know it.
Not personally. Not got your name down, then?
I don't even think the super would have the right credentials, Malinder responded, keeping his voice low, glancing at the CID room door in case Superintendent Curtis had chosen to grace them with his presence. Despite being involved more in operational matters, Crispy was still the go-to geek when online research was required. At the mention of the Clifton Club, his fingers flew across his iPad with the dexterity of a concert pianist. According to the website, its members include a Lord and MPs from across the political spectrum.
And that's a reason to join? Coupland's tone was incredulous. He added the name and address of the club to his daybook. Since Sinclair was wearing that tie, there's a chance he'd been over there or was on his way, possibly meeting a client.
Or his killer, Malinder added. Coupland wasn't the only one keeping an open mind.
Think I'll pay them a visit after I've spoken to his boss, find out what they've got to say about our victim.
I'll go with you, said Malinder, clocking the questioning look on Coupland's face.
You know, in case an interpreter's needed.
Sir, Crispy had angled his body towards DCI Malinder, though his eyes remained trained on his desktop monitor. Coupland marvelled at the number of devices he could operate at once and the ease with which he did so. Too many gadgets required programming these days, that or a password to access them. A central heating system at home he couldn't operate. Meter readings he could no longer submit to his energy supplier. A security alarm he couldn't set. Technology had locked him out of most of his personal life. At least he was still good for putting out the bins.
The DCI nodded at the junior DC. Got the background info I asked for?
Yes, sir. Crispy's brows creased as though he couldn't believe what he was seeing. Sinclair was jailed for a hit and run that killed a mother and baby nearly 40 years ago.
Several pairs of eyes swiveled in his direction, causing his ears to go a deep shade of pink.
Did you say 40 years? Asked Coupland.
Sarge, Crispy nodded. The mother's name was Marie Simpson. Her daughter, Sophie, both killed on impact.
An uneasy feeling formed in Coupland's stomach.
Why's he only just served a jail term?
The question from a DC at the back of the room made Coupland push the feeling away. He tipped his head at Crispy to prompt him for an answer.
Details are sparse. Looks like he walked into Swinton Police Station 5 years ago in a flash of conscience and handed himself in. He served 4 years of an 8-year sentence.
Got any details of the next of kin?
Crispy shook his head as he read from the information on screen.
Nothing on here, Sarge.
It'll be on the original crime report. Give Swinton a call and tell him you're on your way to pick it up. Phone me when you've got the details.
Picking up his car keys, Coupland turned to Turnbull.
Check we've got all the CCTV footage in from the cameras on both sides of the road and those looking onto the square where Sinclair worked. If not, bring them in. One of them must have picked up our guy, possibly his killer.
He turned to Ashcroft.
Did his wife mention his time in prison?
Ashcroft shook his head.
No, although that could have been down to shock. Only one way to find out, isn't there?
Chapter 2. There was no mistaking it was a good area. A tree-lined road, the kind where people do traffic surveys to monitor the number of cars that pass through it and invite their neighbours round for drinks. The house itself was more modest than Coupland anticipated, giving the approach to it. Detached, albeit no more than an arm's span between the neighbouring properties. It was smaller than the other houses on the road. A Mercedes estate parked on the driveway. Not what you'd expect someone who wore a 5 grand watch to be driving, but then office wear was a sort of uniform, Coupland supposed. Dressing like his clients was probably a requirement of Sinclair's job. Coupland looked down at his own chain store ensemble, a suit that was starting to hang loose now Lynn had them eating vegetarian meals a couple of days a week. He'd been meaning to replace it, but the shop he normally went to had gone bust. Not enough people gave a toss what they wore to work anymore. Huge swathes of the population were opting to work from home, festering in PJs and overworn sweaters. Coupland's shirt was new, a Christmas present from Lynn that he'd meant when he told her she really shouldn't have. More garish than he liked. She'd bought it for their next holiday, but it had yet to be booked.
He'd put it on today to please her. The multicoloured pattern was loud, the style middle-aged men wore in beach bars once they'd worked up a tan. It livened him up, she'd said, when he'd sought her reassurance that it wasn't too much. I don't need livening up, I work with the dead, he reminded her. No, Kev, you work for the dead. There's a difference. So he turned up for work in a garish shirt with no tie to please a wife he'd walk over hot coals for. He'd kept his suit jacket unbuttoned, the lucky tin star from Tonto a permanent fixture in his breast pocket. According to his team, he resembled an ageing children's entertainer who'd spent the night in the cells. Lynn had called it partly right then. His shirt had certainly livened up their morning. Miriam Sinclair was in the living room, a woolen throw draped over her shoulders. A younger woman Coupland guessed to be her daughter sat beside her sobbing. They looked up at Ashcroft as he entered the room, their gaze moving to Coupland as he introduced himself. After showing them in, the FLO assigned to the family headed into the kitchen to make drinks. It was amazing how quickly people adapted to a stranger occupying their home, opening cupboards as they looked for coffee one minute, then picking up grandkids from school the next. Maybe it was because they'd had the stuffing knocked out of them that they no longer gave a toss about privacy. Obviously, we're exploring the possibility that this was a random attack, but we need to ask if Adam had fallen out with anyone recently. Anyone who could have harboured a grudge? Coupland asked. Why would he have had any enemies? Adam was a loving family man. Miriam spoke slowly, a new widow learning to talk about her husband in the past tense. He was dedicated to his career, she added. Coupland found himself questioning that statement. He understood the dedication required to be a healthcare worker, or a teacher for that matter. Could someone really be dedicated to making money for others? Adam was a banker. Was making rich folk richer a vocation? A question best kept to himself, he decided, at least until he found a more recipient-friendly way of asking it. He was a good man going about his business, Miriam told them. How in God's name was this allowed to happen? Most people's experience of crime was in the abstract. It was possible if they had the means to insulate themselves from poverty and the effects of it. To live so far away from crack dens and children's playgrounds littered with needles to be convinced it wasn't happening. It was only when violence came knocking down their door that they gave a damn about policing. Crime just didn't happen to people like this. Until it did. Only this time it was different. Beneath the groomed exterior, Sinclair had been in jail, exposed to a network that was bound to have left a stain on him. That's what we want to find out, Coupland said, easing his way into what he really wanted to know. I understand Adam had been in prison. Miriam's face twisted. She'd been sitting forward, resting her elbows on her knees while they'd been talking. Now she straightened her spine, leaning back on the sofa as though increasing the distance between them. And there we have it, she sneered. Didn't take long, did it? For his past to be used against him. She folded her arms, satisfied she'd been proven right. That's not what we're doing, Ashcroft explained quickly, but it might have a bearing on what happened to Adam now. Coupland saw the trust leak from her face, the resignation that they were judging her family over nothing more than a blip, a lapse in concentration that eclipsed who Adam was, whatever good he had in him. Look, as far as we're concerned, he'd served his debt to society, Ashcroft assured her. Coupland wondered how his mouth didn't trip over his words. In his view, dangerous drivers were like terrorists, indiscriminate and lethal. What had gone through Sinclair's mind he could only fathom. To have looked in his rearview mirror at the carnage he'd caused yet keep on driving was beyond him. Sometimes people made errors of judgment, catastrophic ones, yet it was the way they reacted that showed their true character. None of what Sinclair had done marked him out as the decent man his family were suggesting. Coupland drew in a breath. Snap judgments could be dangerous too, until he got his hands on the original case file he was speculating. His sigh was long and slow.
I understand the hit and run happened a long time ago. Were you and Adam together back then? He asked.
Miriam dabbed her nose with a tissue she'd been holding in her lap and nodded.
Yes, although I can assure you I had no idea that anything like that had happened.
Surely there'd been damage to his car?
We hadn't moved in together at that point. He mentioned a minor bump at one point when we spoke on the phone, but by the time I saw him next, his car had been repaired.
The sitting room window looked onto the drive. Ashcroft nodded towards the Mercedes estate parked on it.
Who does that car belong to?
It's mine.
Well, ours, really. Adam wasn't really into cars. He always preferred getting the train into work. I gave him a lift to the station every morning. Obviously, once he told me what he'd done, his reluctance to drive made sense.
Coupland's nod was impatient.
Looking back to when it happened, nothing struck you as odd at the time? He didn't seem unusually emotional or angry?
Nothing so far as I can recall. Don't think I didn't rack my brains when he told me what he'd done to try and find some clue that I hadn't picked up on at the time. Let's face it, he'd been lying to me all those years too, shutting something so awful, so significant out of his mind. It made me wonder for a while if I knew him at all.
She paused, as though running over the minutiae of their lives during that time, sifting for clues.
The truth is, there was never anything erratic about Adam. He was always very focused, very steady. Any extremes in behaviour would have screamed that something was wrong. There just weren't any. The simple fact was he'd been drinking and got behind of the wheel of his car when he shouldn't have.
This is what he told you.
Not just me, the police. He said he wanted to start over with a clean slate, get everything out in the open, no more lies.
What reason did he give you for not coming forward at the time?
We'd been together a couple of years by then and not long become engaged. He told me he'd been scared that I wouldn't have gone through with the wedding if he'd ended up in jail.
And the sudden change in conscience?
She paused, as though composing her thoughts.
His feelings of guilt had never gone away. When our daughter gave birth to Maisie, he realised what he'd deprived his victim's husband of all those years ago. He told me that he'd followed newspaper reports for ages afterwards. One article included a photograph of the woman's husband.
She exhaled noisily.
I've now got some idea of what that poor man went through.
Coupland clenched his jaw. She'd constructed a version of events that made the sorry situation seem better than it was. She'd at least had a life with Sinclair. His victim's loved ones hadn't been so lucky.
Do you know if the victim's husband was aware of Adam's conviction?
Miriam shrugged.
I don't think so. Adam wanted to contact him at one point and tell him how sorry he was. I told him I didn't think it was a good idea. In the end, he wasn't able to find him, so he agreed not to pursue it. Do you think this man had something to do with this?
Early days yet, Coupland answered. At this point in time, we look at everyone sideways.
He paused, waiting a beat to pose the next question.
How did Adam cope in prison?
A shrug. I suspect he kept the reality of it away from me. He didn't like me visiting him. Said there was no reason why I should be punished too. I went a couple of times just to remind myself how he looked, to check he was eating okay and not covered in bruises. He called me regularly. He told me he kept to himself most of the time.
Did he ever mention anyone he was pally with, or someone it was better to avoid?
Miriam considered this.
Not really. His main concern was that we were okay.
Did he have any other visitors?
I think Dominic went from time to time.
His boss?
A nod.
He must have thought a lot of Adam to keep his job open for him.
This time the nod was more vigorous. When she locked eyes with him, her tone was impatient.
That's the point I'm making. Everyone thought the world of him.
Not everyone, thought Coupland.
The fact she looked away when he held her gaze told him she was aware of that too.
Coupland began the ritual of patting his pockets whenever he exited a building, before remembering they'd travelled to the Sinclair's house in a pool car, so lighting up wasn't an option.
"Anyone would think you were conspiring with my missus to make me give up," he grumbled as he slouched into the passenger seat. Just because he'd agreed to go out in a pool car didn't mean he had to bloody well drive it.
"There are worse ideas," Ashcroft retorted, "especially if you plan on kicking a ball about with that grandson of yours any time soon."
"We do all right," Coupland grunted, fishing in his pocket once more when his mobile started to ring. "Nothing for Rashford to lose his sleep over yet, but the little fella's kicking's coming on a treat."
He jabbed his finger on the phone's answer button and barked his name. It was Crispy, calling from Swinton Station.
"I've picked up the hit-and-run file, Sarge. I've got the next of kin details you wanted."
Coupland felt a knot of anxiety form in his stomach.
"Fire away, kiddo," he said, going through the motions of reaching for a pad and pen he knew damn well he wouldn't need.
"Marie's husband was an ex-naval officer. He'd been medically discharged during the Falklands conflict."
Crispy paused.
"I'm afraid I had to look that up, Sarge. I'd never heard of it."
A conflict that was a war in all but name. Coupland scarcely remembered it, but the legacy of it lived on in the homeless shelters and psych wards across the city.
"In your own time," he prompted.
"The file notes are sketchy. Reads as though he suffered from PTSD. Their death sent him over the edge. He started drinking, fell off the radar, I'm afraid. The last reference to him states no fixed abode."
"His name, though,"
Coupland persisted, a last-ditch attempt at his worst fears being proved wrong.
"You'll have his name?"
"Joe Simpson."
Coupland's head flopped back against the passenger headrest.
"Fuck's sake," he groaned after ending the call.
Ashcroft's brow creased as he looked over at him. "Something wrong?"
"I know him."
Coupland knew him as Flemish Joe, a Falklands veteran turned vagrant who'd frequented the Flemish Weaver before his paranoid outbursts got him barred. He'd slept in the pub's doorway for a year as a form of protest, hence the nickname. Coupland had met him when he'd been at a low point in his own life. Birds of a feather and all that. Over time, as Joe began to trust him, he spoke of the family he'd lost, a wife struggling to support him through his own demons and their daughter, born while he'd been at sea, both killed by a hit-and-run driver while he'd been hospitalised following a psychotic episode. The driver who'd ploughed into them that night had never been traced. Or so Coupland had thought.
"Looks like this Joe could be a person of interest," Ashcroft commented when Coupland told him what he knew.
Coupland said nothing, set his face to neutral. He turned his head to look out of the car's passenger window. The shops that had survived lockdown were trading once more, though folks still sidestepped each other on the pavement. The sun doing its best to make up for a poor season had come off the bench to score 3 hot days in a row. Builders strutted about bare-chested as though hairy breasts and pie bellies were something they'd trained for. Joe had never mentioned that the driver who'd killed his wife and daughter had been convicted, though that wasn't the same as him not knowing, Coupland reasoned. Still, he couldn't see why he'd want to keep it quiet. They were friends of sorts, certainly the closest Coupland had come to it. Apart from his family, he didn't have much time for anything outside his job. Did that make him dedicated, or just obsessed? He turned to face Ashcroft.
"I'll check with victim support and the officers who dealt with Sinclair's confession, but I can't see how Joe would have known about this. He doesn't engage with any agencies. To all intents and purposes, he doesn't exist on anyone's radar."
Ashcroft nodded.
"He still needs to be interviewed. We'll need to know for sure whether he was aware that his wife and daughter's killer had been jailed and, crucially, that he'd been released. It would certainly give him a motive."
Coupland grunted. He knew damn well they needed to speak to Joe, but first they'd have to find him.
"Want to prioritise bringing him in?" asked Ashcroft.
Coupland shook his head.
"We speak to Sinclair's boss first, see where he fits into this picture."
Located in a prominent position in one of Salford's most prestigious residential areas, Dominic Neilson resided in one of 3 contemporary-style homes built by an award-winning firm of architects. the timber-fronted, slope-roofed property stood in private grounds, built into an existing development, mature trees surrounding the plot screened each property from the road. Ashcroft eased the car behind a Porsche 911 and its four-wheel drive equivalent, their feet crunching on gravel as they approached the front door. They didn't have time to ring the front doorbell.
"I can't seem to keep them still," said the woman who answered, ushering them inside. "I've been on pins ever since I heard this dreadful news. Honestly, I don't know what the world's coming to."
She led them through a wide reception hall into a split-level living room, decorated in colour palettes that would never be found on a Dulux paint chart.
"I'm Alicia, by the way," she informed them, sweeping her arm wide like a game show hostess, showing them what they could have won if they'd followed lucrative careers. "Please take a seat while I bring some drinks."
The room could have graced the cover of Homes and Garden, bespoke furniture surrounded by pieces of statement art.
Coupland wasn't sure of the statement they were making, other than, "We have money. Shed loads of it."
"Apologies for keeping you waiting."
A square-jawed man sauntered into the room with a smile suggesting he was far from sorry. The detectives remained on their feet.
"I'm sure you've had a lot to attend to," Coupland said, eyeing the pinstripe suit and polka dot tie, the heavy chrome watch that likely cost as much as Sinclair's.
"We spoke on the phone, Mr. Neilson."
Coupland shook the hand that was offered him, introducing Ashcroft before sitting down on a sofa that was as uncomfortable as it was elegant. Dominic's features took on a somber look.
"I've spoken to head office. A message will be circulated around the company informing the staff of Adam's death. This will devastate everyone. He was such a hard worker. A popular colleague, a true professional. Afraid they don't make them like that anymore."
"Had he worked for the firm long?" Coupland inquired.
Dominic blustered a laugh.
"Man and boy, I believe. He was given a long service award not long after I joined, and I've been there over 10 years now."
"It wasn't a watch by any chance, this long service award of his?"
"Yes, it was," answered Dominic. "Afraid I had to buy mine."
He chuckled, seeing Coupland look pointedly at his wrist. Dominic had the polished charm of public school, sharp as a tack, but happy to play the buffoon when it suited him.
"What is it you do exactly? Your firm, I mean."
"Wealth management."
Coupland's face stayed in neutral.
"My boss tried explaining, but I'm still none the wiser," he admitted.
"We help high-net-worth clients plan and grow their investment portfolios in a tax-efficient manner."
"And by high-net-worth, you mean?"
A self-satisfied smile. "People whose bank accounts resemble telephone numbers. Overseas ones at that."
"Nice," Coupland stated, though it was hard to comprehend wealth like that.
It was as though Dominic could read his mind.
"Your salary would be loose change to our clients," he added, laughing at his own joke.
Coupland exchanged a look with Ashcroft that said, "Wanker." Dominic's wife returned with a tray of coffee, halting the conversation whilst inquiring who took sugar, milk, if anyone would like a slice of cake she'd just unpacked from the Waitrose grocery delivery. Coupland shook his head, nodded, patted his stomach as he informed her regretfully that he'd not long had lunch. Ashcroft said no to all, receiving a look from Coupland when Alicia insisted on fetching him a glass of filtered water.
"Can't have you becoming dehydrated," she insisted as she hurried out of the room.
All the while, Dominic's benevolent smile remained in place, undaunted by the presence of the constabulary in his home. When Alicia returned with Ashcroft's water, she placed it on the coffee table before sitting beside her husband.
"Will this take long?" she asked, her smile apologetic. "Only I've a Pilates class in half an hour. Josh has after-school club on Tuesday, and it's nice to have a bit of me time."
Coupland tried not to spill his drink. For him, the banality of everyday living was an out-of-body experience. The minutiae that people with untroubled lives gave a fuck about. Pilates, the child's music grade, which chai seeds to sprinkle on their muesli. Like any of it mattered. He checked his features hadn't fallen into their usual resting twat face, as Lynn called it. The sheer effort it took to let that level of shallowness go unchallenged.
"We don't intend to take up too much of your time,"
was all he'd commit to.
I was telling the detectives what a great guy Adam was, darling, Dominic informed his wife without actually looking at her. That what's happened to him is a terrible shock.
He placed a proprietorial hand on her knee as he spoke. His other hand tapped out a beat on the sofa's upholstery.
I take it that, though you were senior, Adam had more experience in the industry than you? Coupland asked.
Dominic's smile slipped the teeniest fraction.
Well, I'm not sure why that matters. I had nothing but respect for the guy. He was older, yes, but the fire in his belly had gone out. He was no great threat to anyone. So you can't think of a reason why anyone would want to harm him?
Another guffaw.
Bankers, not arms dealers. Arms dealers have to bank somewhere, Coupland stated.
Dominic's face looked serious for a minute.
We carry out due diligence on every client we take on. It's not a given that we'll do business with anyone who comes along.
And there was me thinking money talked, said Coupland.
Business was thriving by the look of it. Despite the economy taking a battering during the pandemic, some sectors had sailed through unscathed. He took a sip of his coffee, enjoying the taste of something that hadn't been spat out of a vending machine. His gaze shifted from husband to wife. Dominic's patrician good looks and air of entitlement, Alicia's flushed face and slightly messy updo. School jock meets head girl.
I gathered from head office that the firm's policy is still for staff to work from home when they can. Was there a specific reason you were in the office today? Coupland inquired.
I needed to pick up some files.
The edges of Coupland's mouth turned down as he considered this.
I'd have thought a setup like yours would be all electronic.
He tipped his head back to finish his drink, savouring the dregs as he rinsed them over his teeth. These days, everyone wanted coffee that tasted like it had been made by an artisan barista. He reckoned he'd need to take out a second mortgage to buy the machine that had produced this stuff. Not denying it was tasty, though. He returned his cup to the tray, treating Dominic to a smile, the way a parent might when trying to coax first words from a toddler. Tonto's name for him was Grumpy. Coupland struggled to think of a finer word. Dominic's eyebrows knotted together.
Sorry?
Coupland ran his tongue over the front of his teeth.
I was saying that a firm like yours, I'd have thought the files would all be electronic by now.
Not a question, granted, but an observation inviting a response. Dominic's face cleared.
They are, but not all of the files can be accessed from the main server when you're working remotely. The file I wanted had been archived, so I couldn't access it from home. You located it easily enough, though, once you were there.
A nod.
It hadn't been filed in the wrong place or given the wrong name.
Dominic's laugh was good-natured.
Not at all. We have strict protocols for things like that. So how come you were there so long?
A chuckle, though less certain.
Well, I'm not with you. You told the uniformed officer who took your statement that you arrived at the office at 8:30 this morning, yet you were still there when my call informing you of Adam's death was put through to you just before 1 p.m. I just wondered what had taken you so long if all you'd gone in for was a file.
It was a couple of files, actually.
Were the other files tricky to find?
No, I just thought I'd make the most of being in the office.
Peace and quiet, you mean?
I suppose.
Coupland nodded. Same as Adam, then.
Another nod.
Did you know he was going to be in?
No.
I mean, I knew he'd like to go in from time to time. It was crowded at his place now his daughter had moved in. Not sure how he coped, to be honest. His place is hardly a mansion. Did you speak to him?
Yes, briefly. I mean, we both had work to be getting on with.
Locating your files?
Yes. More irritable now. I made a few calls, too.
On your mobile?
Neilson shook his head. Signal's not always reliable. Coupland took out his notebook.
Can you give me the names of the people you called?
Why?
It's doing my job, Mr. Neilson. Your colleague was murdered just a 5-minute walk from your office. I need to find out who knew he was there.
How does knowing who I called help?
Maybe you mentioned he was into someone while you were on the phone.
I don't see why. I dare say that for those who are still working from home, going into the office for whatever reason would be a conversation point, even if it was to moan about having to get dressed in the morning again or having to commute. So imagine the things we let slip when we least expect it. I'm guessing you save your clients' contact details on your mobile in case you need to call them when you're not in the office.
A nod.
There you go, then. Shouldn't be too difficult to find them. Oh, and a murder investigation trumps data protection, so you don't need to worry your head about that.
Dominic's demeanour wasn't nearly as affable as it had been 20 minutes earlier. He pursed his lips as he got to his feet to retrieve his phone from a charging unit in the corner of the room. Ashcroft used the break in conversation to ask Alicia for her opinion of Adam.
I've spent a lot of time in Adam's company at corporate events and staff nights out. He was a lovely man, she informed him, nodding.
The character traits of the recently murdered were seemingly a narrow range. Selfless, popular, salt of the earth.
He certainly didn't deserve what happened to him, she added as though further clarification were needed.
Can you tell me when you saw him last?
Oh, let me see.
Her previous answers were gushing and she'd smiled a lot, but at this question she turned to her husband as he returned to the sofa, as though seeking guidance. A squeeze on the knee gave her the reassurance she needed.
Here, DS Coupland, Dominic said, offering Coupland a sheet of paper torn from a school jotter with several names and phone numbers on it.
And these are the calls you made? Coupland clarified.
A nod. Coupland folded it in half without looking, placed it in his pocket.
They were a convincing double act, Coupland conceded. Dominic was one of those people who spoke a lot but gave nothing away. Alicia put a lot of effort into filling the gap between questions with social niceties. Asking if he would like more coffee, if Ashcroft's water was cold enough, if there was anything else she could get them.
In Coupland's job, social conventions were on ration. He dealt with the shocking and those in shock. He didn't have to impress, compete, placate or negotiate. Unless it was to talk to someone out of firing a gun.
You were saying? Ashcroft prompted Alicia.
Our paths hadn't crossed for a while, she admitted. She made little eye contact, concentrating instead on getting her answers out. She wasn't a liar, Coupland conceded. But she was lying to them now. What he needed to work out was whether the lie mattered.
I'm sure they hadn't, Coupland agreed, unless there are in out strange ways D-Wing for corporate events. How did you feel about him taking up residence at one of Her Majesty's...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.